What's the deal with oxalates? Are they this terrible anti-nutrient that everyone needs to avoid at all costs? First of all, no. But second of all, let's talk about the grain of truth behind the oxalate phobia. About 80% of kidney stones are a type of kidney stone called calcium-oxalate stones. Yes, they are made with oxalic acid binding to calcium. And one of the biggest risk factors for developing calcium oxalate stones is something called hyperoxaluria, which is a lot of oxalates in the urine. But here's the thing. Most of those oxalates come from the ones your body makes. And this is why dehydration is such a huge risk factor for kidney stones. When you're dehydrated, your urine is more concentrated, including having higher concentrations of oxalates. And that's why drinking enough water is the number one best thing you can do to reduce kidney stone risk. Now, there are some high oxalate foods like spinach, but studies have shown that high oxalate foods contribute the minority to the oxalates in urine, maybe at most 20 to 40%. And this is closely related to the composition of the gut microbiome and how many oxalate degrading bacteria you have in your gut. Actually, having oxalate degrading bacteria in your gut is incredibly protective against kidney stones. And again, the risk here is oxalate concentration in the urine. So if you're hydrating, the importance of dietary oxalates is really moot. But studies don't consistently show that high oxalate foods impact kidney stone risk at all. In fact, some very high oxalate foods like green tea actually reduce kidney stone risk. It's worthwhile noting that low calcium actually increases the amount of oxalates that are absorbed into the body from high oxalate foods. And also that there are a couple of nutrients that our bodies do make oxalates from that increases oxalate production. And that includes high dose of vitamin C. There are a couple of studies in men showing high dose vitamin C, like 10 grams daily, can increase kidney stone risk, as well as the amino acid hydroxyproline found in bone broth and collagen supplements. But kidney stone risk is multifactorial. Again, the best things you can do are hydrate, eat a diet abundant in fruits and vegetables, go easy on the salt, get enough calcium, and there is some indication that high animal protein diets can increase kidney stone risks, probably because of that hydroxyproline thing. So because this really isn't super clear cut, low oxalate diets are not currently part of the recommendations for people with recurring kidney stones. But if you really struggle to stay hydrated and you definitely don't get enough calcium, reducing dietary oxalates might be a good idea. As always, talk to your doctor. There are a couple of things you can do to decrease absorption of oxalates besides having a healthy gut microbiome. That includes making sure to eat high oxalate foods with lots of calcium. That's why spinach and cheese go so well together. And cooking usually reduces oxalates in these foods as well, so go for steamed spinach instead of a raw spinach salad. And what about oxalates as anti-nutrients, leaching valuable minerals from your body? Look, oxalate is a salt. It is oxalic acid bound to a mineral, often calcium or zinc. And studies do show that we don't absorb all of the mineral that that oxalic acid is bound to when we eat high oxalate foods. But having oxalate degrading bacteria in our gut, which includes some really ubiquitous probiotic species like bifidobacterium and lactobacillus, does mean that we can absorb more of the minerals from foods like that. And there is no mechanism by which the oxalates in spinach, for example, are binding with our body's calcium and leaching it from our bodies. So where oxalates earn their anti-nutrient status is by making it harder for us to absorb all of the minerals in these foods. How much we absorb is very gut microbiome dependent, but there is no mechanism here for oxalates to leach minerals from our bodies. So if you are a calcium oxalate kidney stone former, it's definitely worth talking to your doctor about whether or not it's appropriate for you to decrease dietary oxalates. There's also a genetic condition that can cause oxalate sensitivity. That's about a 1 in 3 million frequency, so it's very rare. For everyone else, there's no reason to avoid high oxalate foods. This includes some of the most nutrient-dense, health-promoting foods out there.